hello. I'm talking today about the Duke and Crusader Robert Curthose, one of my favorite people from the 11th century. He was, of course, the eldest son of William the Conqueror, you know, the famous Duke of Normandy, King of England. And his mother was Matilda of Flanders, who was also his father's cousin, but never mind that. We don't know much about Robert's early life. He was born circa 1052, and in 1063, his father appointed him Count of Maine. But since he was only about 11 years old at this time, it's doubtful he ever held much real power in Maine. And anyway, a revolt handed that region over to Hugh V just 6 years later. So the first we really get to see of Robert Curthose is in 1077. Now, Curthose, if you're wondering, it translates to roughly shorty pants. And this was apparently a nickname given to him by his father, with whom he probably never had a great relationship. And that sort of becomes clear in this incident. In 1077, Robert was in his early 20s. He was entertaining some friends at Laggall in Normandy, and his younger brothers William and Henry were in the loft upstairs. Well, they decided that it would be hilarious to dump the contents of a chamber pot over their brother's head. Robert, of course, grew angry. The brothers fought, it was a violent altercation, and William the Conqueror himself was forced to break it up. However, he failed to punish his younger sons for their mischief. So shortly after this, we see Robert in open rebellion, leading an attack on the capital of Rouen. But it's clear that Robert was not the only one of his generation growing restless with the old guard, for he was joined by some rather high-profile friends. One was Robert de Bellamy, the son of Earl Roger de Montgomery of Shrewsbury, and another was William de Bretville, the son of Earl William Fitzosborne of Hereford. So all three of these young men were the sons of very powerful Anglo-Norman lords, but none had yet attained much power of their own. Well, their combined forces failed to take Rouen. In fact, they were driven off quite quickly. They retreated to the castle at Ramillard, and when William attacked them there, Robert actually fled to the court of his uncle, Count Robert I of Flanders. He remained in rebellion for the next 2 years, making intermittent raids on Norman territory, and he eventually gained the backing of French King Philip I, who gave him the castle at Gerberoy. But when William attempted to attack him at Gerberoy, Robert actually led a daring sortie against him, and he managed to injure not only his father, but also his brother William. Now, it's probably only thanks to Robert's mother, with the leading magnates of Normandy, that the two sides ever came to terms, but finally at Easter 1080, father and son were publicly reconciled. King William followed this up by sending his eldest son as far away from Normandy as possible, all the way to northern England, where King Malcolm III of Scotland had lately been invading. So Robert duly led a campaign northward. He compelled the Scottish king to a treaty at Falkirk, and he also established a new castle on the Tyne, which later grew into the city, Newcastle. But in 1083, Robert's mother died, and after this he took to a sort of self-imposed exile. Unfortunately, we don't know very much about this time in his life, although he did father at least three illegitimate children. One was Richard, who later died in a hunting accident. One was William, who later went on crusade. And there was also an illegitimate daughter, who married the Norman baron, Helias de Sansons. We also know that during his adventures, Robert sought to marry the powerful and wealthy Margravine Matilda of Tuscany. But in this, he was wholly unsuccessful, and in fact, he remained unmarried for the next 10 years. Now, in September 1087, William the Conqueror died at Rouen. And although Robert was nearby at Abbeville, he refused to come to his dying father's side. According to the Conqueror's wishes, the realm was now divided. Robert received the Duchy of Normandy, but his younger brother William received the Kingdom of England. This was a situation the Anglo-Norman barons had been fearing, for they were accustomed to having just one lord for both their English and their Norman lands. But now they had two lords, and what was worse is that those two lords were often at odds with each other. So many of the barons were willing to rebel, and in the following year, this is exactly what happened. Robert's uncles, Bishop Odo of Bayeux and Count Robert of Mortain, were counting on this, and they secured the southeastern ports of England for Robert's expected invasion. At the same time, other barons took up arms and readied their castles, and this kept King William very busy for something like 2 months, but ultimately, Robert failed to ever arrive. The whole rebellion fell apart. His uncles were banished from England, they lost all their English lands, and what was worse is that William then began to turn the situation around. He began to increase his own influence in Normandy, and this he did by shows of wealth and by flattery, by promising privilege and protection, and also by outright bribery. But Robert, by contrast, seems to have taken a somewhat flippant, even perhaps lazy approach to governance. He was pleased to let his friends make important decisions, but this left other barons feeling alienated and sometimes even attacked. That being the case, rebellion did break out in Normandy, and in 1090, rebels were closing in on Rouen itself. Duke Robert rode to relieve the city, and he was joined by his friend Robert de Bellamy and by his brother Henry. But fighting in the city grew intense, and Robert's advisors compelled him to withdraw for his own safety. Henry, however, remained in the city, and he went on to defeat the rebel leader Conan Pilatus, whom he then had thrown from the top of Rouen Castle in a show of unwarranted authority. Now, this must have left Robert feeling somewhat jealous, for he soon reconciled with his other brother William, and these two then turned on Henry, whom they besieged at Mont-Saint-Michel later that year. Robert also accompanied William to Scotland, where he helped to renegotiate a new treaty with King Malcolm III. But unfortunately, the brothers' pact of cooperation soon proved one-sided. When yet another revolt broke out in Maine, Robert was compelled to return to Normandy alone without his brother's support. Inevitably, the two fell out again. William later reconciled with Henry, and these two then proceeded to undermine Robert's authority. So Robert must have been feeling rather frustrated with his duchy in 1095 when suddenly the First Crusade was called. Now this, of course, was a huge deal, as it was considered a sacred duty to liberate the revered city of Jerusalem from its current rulers. Robert eagerly took crusading vows, but he just had one problem, in that he couldn't quite afford the massive amount required for such a campaign. A papal legate therefore helped him to secure a loan from his brother, with the collateral being nothing less than Normandy itself. Well, William all too happily raised the amount, a princely sum of 10,000 marks, and even brought the money to Robert in person in September of 1096. Well, Robert embarked on crusades shortly after this, and he was met by other crusaders at Constantinople the following year. During the summer of 1097, these forces then fought their way to Antioch, which was besieged. But the effort proved grueling amid a sweltering heat with diseases rampant, and many crusaders simply abandoned the effort, including Robert's brother-in-law, Count Stephen of Blois. Finally, after nearly a year's bombardment, the city was captured in June of 1098. Sadly, many crusaders then fell to infighting, as each staked a claim on a share of the spoils. Duke Robert was purportedly one of the few who actually urged a peace and unity among them. Still, it was with a diminished company that he pressed on for Jerusalem, and he finally reached that great city on 6 June 1099. Jerusalem, of course, was also besieged, and it was later captured amid a notorious bloodbath about 1 month later. With his vows fulfilled, Robert did not linger long in the Levant. He departed in September, but it was a long journey home, and while wintered in Apulia, he actually married Sibylla of Conversano. As Duchess of Normandy, she later gave Robert a son called William in October of 1102. Sadly, she died the following year, and William was entrusted to his brother-in-law, the Baron Helius de Saint-Saëns. Meanwhile, in August of 1100, King William II of England was hunting in New Forest when he was accidentally shot and killed. One might think that Robert now stood to inherit the throne of England, but that was not to be, for his other brother Henry was also hunting in New Forest that day, and he immediately seized the throne for himself. Well, Henry's many enemies soon flocked to Robert's court, and it was probably they who planned the subsequent invasion of England, especially the dubious former treasurer, Ranulf Flambard, who escaped from the Tower of London in February 1101. Well, King Henry was aware of the impending invasion, and he had the coasts of England patrolled, but nonetheless, Robert was able to land unopposed at Portsmouth on 20 July 1101, and then he was joined by Earl William de Warenne of Surrey and Sheriff Ivo de Grandmesnil of Leicester. In the event, war was averted at the last moment, the brothers sat down for peace talks, and they agreed to the Treaty of Alton. But obviously Henry was not content with this. As soon as the crisis was over, he began to increase his own influence in Normandy, in much the same way as brother William had done. He quickly won important barons over to his side, and he encouraged rebellion throughout the duchy. Duke Robert actually went to England in 1106 to confront him about this, but nothing really changed. Henry openly attacked Robert's vassals in Normandy, and so the Duke raised an army to fight him. Now, churchmen from both sides could see what was coming, and they urged the two brothers to reach an accord, but a clash proved inevitable. On Friday, 28 September, the two sides met in battle at Tinchebrai, and it was a total defeat for Duke Robert. His old friend Robert de Bellamy actually escaped the fray, only to be arrested at a later date, but Duke Robert and his cousin Count William of Mortain were both captured, and both were then imprisoned for life. Robert was held in honorable custody, a kind of forced retirement, first at Wareham and then Devizes, and then on to Bristol in 1126. Meanwhile, Henry posed as Normandy's protector, and with the duchy in his grasp, he firmly prevented Robert's only son William from ever coming into his inheritance. Although William fought for Normandy with Flemish and rebel aid from 1118, he was eventually defeated, and he died of wounds incurred in battle in 1128. His father, Robert Curthose, lived on at Cardiff, where he remained imprisoned until his death in 1134. He was then buried at Gloucester. That's the life of Robert Curthose. Thank you so much for watching.